My name is Andra Rudder. I'm the creator and director of Lord & Andra Gallery's Director's Chair. And today, we'll be featuring Levon Jones from Rochester, hailing from the beautiful town of Rochester. He is one of the top filmmakers and producers of art, culture, hip-hop, and he works with tons of artists. My interaction with him was because we met during the time 2020 for a mutual friend of ours, Michael Anthony Pagez, who exhibited his work in the Macy's Gallery.
Today for Michael.
Yes.
Giuseppe from Italy. I studied set design all my life, from artists, and I do a lot of set, building a lot of, you know, props and scenery and production company we got in Atlanta. So I work with Michael Anthony. This is Giuseppe. Welcome to the art world.
Thank you.
right now sitting at my work in the window display. I do everything, fashion, production, and whatever we can. Hi, Alan Asley. This is Macy, and welcome to the Art World.
I'm here at Macy's Herald Square. I'm a visual merchandiser and window installer, window dresser. And we are here installing windows for Black History Month at Macy's Herald Square. So I got into window dressing and window production about 3 years ago. I was always a visual merchandiser, just inside of retail, and just wanted to expand. So I knew some people and knew all their stories, and then I met someone from Macy's about a year and a half ago, and I've been here ever since. What I like about working here is the collaborative nature, and that we also have a lot of fun when we're installing windows. There can be frustrating moments, of course, with anything that you're doing, you know, but I love it so much that the frustration just kind of melts right off. because at the end of the day, once we have a full window set up, it's really awesome to just be outside and seeing people enjoying what we've created for them. So the frustrations go out the window when we see all the smiles from people on the street and customers and things like that.
It's like being an artist, like you get people get to see your work.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
And it's a good feeling to have somebody appreciate what you do.
It is a great feeling, yes, creatively. Especially children are my favorite because their eyes, they get so magical to them, and honestly they have no idea what goes on in the windows, and they see it and they light up, and that really makes my heart skip a beat and makes me know that I'm doing something that's worthwhile for people, you know?
And can you tell me, how do you feel about doing art instead of fashion? Switching to doing the art instead of fashion.
Oh, in the windows.
Yeah.
I actually really enjoy having this be more of an art installation versus like a fashion art installation because, you know, a little variety. Everything can't, I mean, fashion is art, but sometimes you just need to calm down a little bit and just like stand and focus at people's artistic abilities with other mediums other than clothing and textiles. So I really think it's a nice refresher. And also gives people an opportunity to like almost go to museums without having to be in a museum. And exposure for the other artists, and you know, hopefully spark some intrigue intrigue to the arts and culture. So, hi, my name is Ashante, and we are here at Macy's Herald Square for Black History Month, featuring Michael Anthony Tibaz. Welcome to the art world.
Furthermore, here is Levon Jones. Levon, tell me a little bit about yourself.
Well, my name is Levon Jones. I was born in Mississippi. I was fortunate enough to come up north, which I thought it would be a blessing, seeing how the South was. I came here at a young age with two of my other siblings looking for a better life, coming from the South, from a one-parent mother. And we came to Rochester in the winter of maybe 1969 or 70, right after the riots.
I was named after my mother's father and brother. His name was Levon. At the age of 9, I made an impact on the world, then was forced into obscurity. Slavery system taught me to have a hatred at a very young age. I remember my mother telling me she wasn't able to go to school because she had to pick cottons in the fields of Mississippi. At 9, I couldn't believe the world was so unfair and unbalanced. All I could see was a little girl at the age of 3 picking cotton. She had a third grader education. She was my mother. She was very special and dear to me. She had mother wit and will to win. When I went to kindergarten, I could spell my name, knew my telephone number, where I live, ABC, and I could count to 100. She taught me everything she knew before I went to kindergarten. So I was very smart, was very shy, and an introvert because I didn't understand the people. I was always in another world, the art world.
Awesome. I know most of your viewers probably haven't seen your clipped or YouTube movie about your recent class action suit against the city of Rochester, because I understand when you were around 9, you had a drawer and designed this building, and you weren't really given credit for it. I wanted to focus on that a little bit since we're here on focusing on Black History Month, and you being a black man, obviously, I would like you to, you know, give us insight for those who haven't seen your movie, which was excellent, by the way, telling the story from when you were younger to how you were kind of like shunned and not given the credit.
Oh, okay. Well, in 1976, 1972, I was 9 years old. I attended fourth grade city school district in New York City in Rochester. My mother was always telling me to like stay in school, so I listened to her and took the advice, kept me out of trouble. And like, but my passion was art. So, but one day they had a contest for all city school district kids, and I submitted my drawing, and my drawing was selected to be a winner. But like, I never looked into it as I would be here having to prove something that I did at 9 years old, being a grown adult, so.
Amazing.
Hello, my name is James Young. We have a very exciting show for you today. We have a filmmaker. Well, he does everything. He's a filmmaker, he's a producer, he wrote the script. He's gone out and found budding stars to play in the movie. And the name of the movie is called I Won. And without further ado, I'd like to get right into this. Let me introduce to you Levon. We call him Rastavon Jones. Please, I introduce Mr. Jones to you.
Hey, thanks. Thank you.
Let's jump right into this, as I mentioned earlier, and let's talk about you're 9 years old, you're in the fourth grade. Set this whole scenario up for us.
Okay. When I was young, like, I knew I was going to be an artist when I was young. Even my mother told me that, like, you know, that was my calling, because I was always drawing, like, things like other people. Like, TV wasn't a big issue to me. Like, I would be drawing while my brothers and I would be fighting over who's going to watch what. So, and drawing kept me occupied, because it was like a time where there wasn't video games and we didn't have, like, Game Boys and all of that type of stuff. So we had to entertain ourselves. So, but drawing was just like something that, like, you know, it was like my way of freedom, my expression. So, like, you know, that, and that's the one thing that made me stand out, because there wasn't other things that, like, you know, I wasn't picked. I was a dark-skinned kid, so I never raised my hand. I never got picked. I never got to pass out the cookies or nothing like that. But, like, I would always just be drawing on my desk all the time. So one day in the year of 1973, the teacher Mary Shank at number 20 school announced that there was going to be a contest for a building and a restaurant. So, and it was for all city school district. It wasn't just for my school or just for my class.
So this was a contest throughout the school district, not just this one particular school, but throughout the entire school district.
Yeah.
Okay.
It was throughout the city school district. So that day I was like, I was just so elated, because then it was finally something that, like, you know, that I could stand out with what I did. It piqued my interest, because, like, school really wasn't interest to me, because, like, a lot of the stories, I didn't see myself in the stories, like Cinderella and all of that. So I would be busy just daydreaming, looking out the window. So, but, like, that day I was, like, very, very elated that, like, this was something that I would be able to excel in. Because I knew I was a better drawer than all the kids in the classroom, because I would see their little scribbles and stuff like that, and then they would see my stuff, and it was like, yeah, you could draw. So we got that yellow. She gave us this yellow, that yellow paper that used to draw on back when you was little, that mm-hmm. thick paper. Mm-hmm. So she passed that out, and everybody got one. So I went home that day, and like everybody in my house, it's like all the commotion going on. I can remember like it was yesterday, and just putting my stuff, newspaper, getting my stepfather a newspaper, putting it down on the floor, and just putting my paper down. And just started drawing. When I started, it had to be like, I could just see like everybody just, like the house just, all the noise and the commotion. Then all of a sudden, I was the last one. I knew all the kids was gonna draw square. So like, I was just like, it was 1973 and Burger King, Carol's had just changed to Burger King. You had McDonald's with the clown. Then you had Where's the Beef with Wendy's. So. My whole thing was burger, like restaurant and building. So I'm gonna put the burger on top of the building and put the elevator up to the hamburger. And when I drew the drawing on the paper, I didn't use pencil, I used all pens, so I could make no mistakes. So I used books to make all my lines straight, make sure all my lines is perfect. I must have ran out about like maybe like 6 pens, all the black ink out of the pens, drawing in the windows and putting all the lines in. And then the final was the hamburger. I used like certain things that had certain shapes to make the shape of the burger from the top to make the top bun and the bottom buns. And then I drew the lines all the way in the window. And when I seen it, I was like, wow, it's like I'm an artist.
I want to stop right there, because I want to try to really paint this picture so the audience really sees what it is that you're putting together for us. One, you're in school, mm-hmm. and you're not interested in the basic topics or the subjects that are basically in school because you didn't feel that they related to you.
Yeah.
Then with the opportunity of this contest, this now, I'm assuming for the first time that now you're elated because here's something that you can do that you can flourish in because of the way, because this is your art, this is your passion. They've tapped now into what you enjoy doing. What are the emotional thoughts as I'm listening to you? You're telling me how you, you know, meticulously drew these lines straight, made circles with different objects that you had.
Mm-hmm.
What was the emotional state that you were going in? Did you think that you were going to win, or did you know that you were going to win?
No, I didn't think I was going to win. I didn't think I had a chance because, like, first of all, I thought because I was black that they wasn't going to pick me. Not, you know, just being like a dark-skinned black kid, being a black boy, that, like, you know, I was also alienated in a lot of things where I would raise my hand or I would be like trying to be helpful or to be picked. And that's one thing that I learned as I got older in life. That's why I became a director, because to be on the other side of the camera, pick me. And, you know, all the time people are not really going to pick you. So I decided to get on the other side of the camera. But that day, I didn't really think I was going to win. I didn't even think I had a chance. But the one thing that just elated me that, like, I started something and I finished it. I didn't have to have nobody, like, tell me to do. I did it out of my imagination. I did it for my drive, for my passion of art. And I was just pleased that, like, you know, looking at my work of something that was sublime to me.
So you completed the work that night,
mm-hmm.
and you took it to school the next day.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Okay, so when I took the work back to school the next day, I handed in the work, and it was just back to business as usual, back to school business.
How long did it take? Because I'm assuming that there must have been at least a few hundred, if not thousands, of students participating in this contest. How long did it take before they let the schools know who the winner was?
I want to say it had to be like maybe like a good 3 to 4, 4 or 5, maybe 4 weeks, okay. Something like that. Because all I remember is just one day being in class and then the teacher making an announcement that I had won.
Okay, yeah, tell us about that. That had to be exciting.
Oh, yeah. It's just, I was numb. It's just like what did I win? Like, you know, it's like I figured that I had won. And then, like, I'm thinking that, like, the newspaper is going to be there and I'm going to be on the news. I'm going to be in the World Book of Guinness. Or just, like, I thought I was going to get, like, all these praises and stuff like that. And then after she announced that I won, it was like right back to business again, right back to school, right back to the lesson, and that was it.
When you won, what was stipulated to this contest?
What the announcement, just like when she made the announcement, I forgot to say that with the announcement, the prize was a free trip to the grand opening of Burger King in Midtown Plaza. Because Carol's had changed the Burger King, and the grand opening of the one in Midtown was about to open, and that was in 1973.
Okay.
So, like, I was the first one to go to eat at Burger King, but it wasn't like, I didn't feel like, you know, it was like I was elated. Because my whole thing was that, like, my mother took us to Burger King, Carol's, all the time. Every time we used to go to Dennis, my mother used to take us to Carol's on West Main. So it wasn't like that was just a big deal. Like, thank you.
I returned back to school the next day. I handed Miss Shank the drawing, and it was back to school business as usual.
We don't doodle in class. We pay attention to our books and papers, okay? Did you get your homework done?
No.
Did you have breakfast?
No.
Well, you know what? Just get back to work. Get your work done, and I might have a treat for you, okay?
Yeah.
Can you do that?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay, cool. All right.
Faye, could you ask the rest of the team to come into the boardroom, please? Thanks.
Hello, honey. How are you? Stop yelling. I've been real busy at the office. You know that. I'll make it up to you. And we'll spend more time together, but I'm going through thousands of drawings for the design of this building. And I'm getting pressure from the developers. And that could be a problem. So you gotta be more understanding. I'm doing the best I can with limited resources. Several people left the firm, and it's making it more difficult. So I'm going through the drawings right now, one at a time. And that's going to take a while. But I'll be home, I'll make it up to you. I promise. We'll go to dinner at your favorite place, Tornado's. I know how much you love it there. I'm not liking these drawings at all that I'm seeing so far. Looks like children design these and drew them. This one looks like a stove with cabinets. It's hard to find good people. All right. Oh my God! I think I found it! This is impossible. This drawing is so much better than all the others. It's ridiculous. The building at the top is a spaceship. Like a UFO. And it's on the very top of the building. I can't tell just how big the building is going to be, but this is just the scale. Honey, we're going to make a fortune off of this. Wait a minute. We got one problem. This has been signed by someone, Levon Jones. Well, we're going to have to change this somehow and take this name off, because I'm taking credit for it, and we'll be on Easy Street because the developer will be ecstatic when he sees this. This is an amazing design. I can't believe a 9-year-old kid did this. But Faith, it's all about me. So I'll call you back as soon as I'm done, and I'll make it all up to you. I promise, baby. You got it. Goodbye.
And then after that, 1976 was the grand opening of the building, and I heard the announcement on the WDKX. And I'm listening for my name, and I'm thinking I'm going to hear my name, and they're going to announce me, and I'm going to get an invite to the grand opening. And 76, they had the grand opening for the building, and no invite. I wasn't invited, not mentioned, or anything.
Were the architects aware of this contest?
See, that I wouldn't know, because I was only 9 years old. I didn't have information. I just recently found out who the architects are, who are taking credit for the building.
Okay, so let's now really bring this up. The school district, not just this class, but the school district, and one can only assume that apparently they must have gotten in touch with the potential owners of this building and told them that they're going to do a contest school board wide, citywide, and that the students know that they're going to give you their artist conception of what this building should look like.
Mm-hmm.
Levon Bolton. I'm here to see Mr. Rex.
Let me see if he's available.
Okay.
Ronald Goldberg here to see you right now. Oh, okay. I'll send him in right away. Thanks.
Goldberg.
Hey, Ronald, how are you? Good to meet you. I've been looking at developing a project down at 12 Corners in the city.
Well, it's a good location for a business venture. What does that have to do with me? My business is a high school.
Well, actually, I need your help.
My help? How could I understand?
Well, I was thinking it would be a great idea to have 4th graders submit design drawings of their own of what my restaurant would look like. I think you get some pretty interesting ideas from that, and we have a contest, and the winner will get to go to Burger King when they open.
I like that idea. Great project for the kids and great project for the school.
Thanks very much for meeting me.
Well, thank you.
And then after that, 1976 was the grand opening of the building, and I heard the announcement on the WDKX, and I'm listening for my name, and I'm thinking I'm going to hear my name, and they're going to announce me, and I'm going to get an invite to the grand opening. And 76, they had the grand opening for the building, and no invite. I wasn't invited, not mentioned, or anything.
Were the architects aware of this contest?
See, that I wouldn't know because I was only 9 years old. I didn't have information. I just recently found out who the architects are, who are taking credit for the building.
Okay, so let's now really bring this up. The school district, not just this class, but the school district, and one can only assume that apparently they must have gotten in touch with the potential owners of this building and told them that they're going to do a contest school board-wide, city-wide, and that the students know that they're going to give you their artist conception of what this building should look like.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now we're at that point. You've won, the artwork is gone. Now, the building has been constructed,
mm-hmm.
and as you're saying, no one has ever mentioned you whatsoever.
2 weeks went by, and I wasn't even thinking about the contest. Then it happened.
Class, I have an announcement to make. The winner of the contest is Levon Jones.
Sat there in a daze thinking, I won. Then it hit me. What did I win? Trip to Burger King. My mother took us out to eat at Carol's every time we went to the dentist by Bullhead Plaza. Then once again, it was back to school business.
Now, please take out your social studies books and turn to page 134.
Oh, he's here? Send him right in. Thank you.
Changing Scene Restaurant.
my name is Michael Antoni Cadiz. Here I am at the Castle Gallery, 98 Orchard Street. Here I am doing it again at the gallery, and it's been amazing, you know, coming here again and knowing that Thursday that you come and do some pop stuff. I do pop art. I've been painting since I was 9 years old. This is amazing to come here and really express more work and character as, you know, what the art really explains is dignity and dedication. I dedicate my hands and my life to, you know, pop art, and I think it's quite amazing.
Yo, Michael, so could you tell us where you're from?
Actually, I'm from Brooklyn, New York. I was born and raised in Bedford-Stuyvesant. I come from the school of hard knocks.
And can you tell me some of who are the artists you're influenced by?
I'm influenced by a lot of different artists. I'm influenced by my mother. My mother was the one who was buying me brushes when I was a child. And I was doing unusual things, and I think my family saw that, and he was like, wow, this guy is not doing coloring books, he's doing something crazy. But I'm really influenced in the 80s when I got out of there and moving into the 90s. I was really, really captured by a lot of people, like Andy Warhol.
Bounce. 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 Shit, relax your mind. Let your conscience be free. You're now rolling with them thugs from the ROC. See? Rolling with them thugs from the ROC. Seagull, Seagull in the house. Sick bastard. Yeah. Get your wig pushed back. By the wig pushed back. Leg in the house.
Still here, never left. Still bust, more or less. Still puff. Bitch.
Young Hova in the house.
Chica.
Yeah.
Chris Sipper, six dipper, wrist splitter, nigga. Hold up, love. Every time you see Jigga, man, I'm rolling on dubs. Don't forget about them blaze shit, chopping it up. It's the motherfucking rock, bitch, you hotter than us. J-Ho, about to change my name to J-Peso. But in the meantime, call me where your mates go. On a platinum Yamaha, I got the engine gunning. Throwing it up like liquor on an empty stomach. Shh. You don't hear nothing? Who that Mac? Nah, dog, that's M. Bleak coming.
Who the fuck want what? Catch Bleak in South Beach, out of the reach of the police. Jack on my lap,
yeah.
Yak in my pocket, smoking a sticky chocolate.
Ooh-wee.
Holla if you want drama with
the dynasty, a male Bleak, Jigga, and Seagull. That's an eagle dog, who else but me? Rock ears, rock wears, bandanas, and white tees. Me without a gun, dog, unlike me. You know I keep the heat right under the white tee. 3XT, I'm eating now, you can't see the pound. Got low gut, so the gaps are tougher. I run wild, gun high, LA style. Bang the run wild, gun high, LA style. Bang the run wild, gun high, LA style. Run, run, run.
Please repeat after me, it's only one rule. Please repeat after me, it's only one rule. Please repeat after me.
will not lose.
Thank you. I'm a warrior, a black rider. I ride for black, it's just like a cider. I'm a warrior, a black rider. I ride for black, it's just like a cider. Like a cider. K-Line is a warrior. Like Huey Newton. K-Line is a warrior. A warrior. I'm a warrior, a black rider. I ride for black, it's just like a cider. And Huey P. and Bobby Seale, just to let you know that this is real. We are the true protectors of blackness. Caskets made for our bones and our ashes. And you're ratchet at the enemy not. Your own black family, that's the enemy's plot. I ride on the system, try to brutalize us. Back in the past, they try to neutralize us. They try to do anything to divide us. Killed our leaders and try to hide us. Marauders don't die, we multiply. At night, look up, black holds the sky. Black riders, all my soldiers rise. Keep your heads to the sky, let the soul arise. I'm a warrior, a black rider. I ride for black, it's just like a cider. I'm a warrior, a black rider. I ride for black, it's just like a cider. Like a cider. K-Line is a warrior. Like Huey Newton. K-Line is a warrior. I ride for my people, never sold crack, cause the effect is evil. Don't let it defeat you, I ride for intelligence, cause ignorance is hell, but knowledge and wisdom is heaven. And I ride for my comrades, my sisters and brothers die for each other during enemy combat. I ride on the crooked police that killed Craig Hurd, ain't show no grief. I ride on the shitty cops that killed Sean Bell and gave him 50 shots. I ride for black unity, cause I'm tired of Willie lynching niggas in my community. I ride for liberation, cause every person deserves to be free in every nation. I ride if you ride for me, die for you if you die for me. That's true camaraderie. I'm a warrior, a black rider. I ride for black, it's just like a cider. I'm a warrior, a black rider. I ride for black, it's just like a cider, like a cider. K-Line is a warrior, like Huey Newton. K-Line is a warrior, a warrior. I ride for the truth, ride for the youth, ride if they shoot any of my troops. I ride for a truce to unite gangs, if only we have a productive aim. Black destruction's here, we have to fight against it and stay productive. The enemy's relentless, he's ready to kill us any second. We need protection, we are the weapon. Fight against oppression, they say to kill the Panther, but we're the resurrection. Here to make correction, right now the death is of my people. I'm here to bring life and peace too. But if they try to take my life, I got the peace too. I would defend myself with the heat too. All my riders, don't let them defeat you. Live our generation, power to the people. I'm a warrior, a black rider. I ride for blackness just like a cider.